Namaste, I'm Shashi Gosain and welcome to the YouTube channel Simple Hinduism, which is dedicated to simplify the Hindu religion, culture, fast and feasts. So now we're on to chapter 4 of the Bhagavad Gita, which we've titled The Knowledge. And what we've seen is that the journey from the first chapter to the fourth chapter is one of elevated levels of integration and tuning our thought processes. In the first chapter, we're at the level of selfishness, where we see the gains and losses in our lives and in everything around us. And as we move to the second and third chapters, we were introduced to the concept of desireless action. Shri Krishna opens the fourth chapter by giving us the ultimate knowledge. And this is giving up the results of our action and dedicating it to a higher ideal. He says he first gave this divine knowledge to Viivasvaan, the sun. The sun became the first karmayogi, and it works tirelessly without getting tired and just giving of itself. The sun then gave this knowledge to Manu, who is considered to be the first human being on earth, very much like Adam in the Bible. And that's why us humans are called Manushya. Manu gave to Ikshvaaku, the first king in the solar dynasty or Soorya vansh. All these kings were kshatriyas or warriors. And Krishnaji made this point to Arjuna, who's a warrior himself, so that he can better appreciate the teachings. So Krishnaji says that cosmic intelligence is the source of this knowledge. And this is another beauty of Hinduism. Not one single person has taken credit for the whole religion. It's something that's coming from divine, has been for years and will continue. But because it was passed down by word of mouth, a lot of meanings got lost through the generations. So the Lord says he has to come to earth every now and then to reiterate the original principles. Isn't that beautiful? So Shri Krishnaji says he's on this earth to give a message of Gita to Arjuna. So why did he choose Arjuna? Well, Arjuna was not only a trusted friend, but he was also a warrior. A warrior has a mixture of what we call sattva and rajas mentality, in which they are very balanced in this world. This could have been given to a Brahmin, but Brahmin is what we call sattvic, and they only have a one vision, and they stick to those rules, and they find it very difficult to communicate to the general public because they really don't know how they're actually reacting to everything. So this is the difference between a Brahmin and a Kshatriya, where the Kshatriya has got a more wider look, as they are in tune with majority of the people, not on daily basis, on daily battles, and not just imparting knowledge, you know, book knowledge. So Arjuna is not only just a trusted friend of Krishna, but they had this beautiful rapport between them. They could confide each other's fears to each other. And that's usually very difficult for a Kshatriya. As we've seen in chapter 1, he's in despair and he's actually asking for help. Such a beautiful relationship. But then Arjuna goes on to ask that if the knowledge was given to the sun was there much, much longer than Krishnaji was. And Krishnaji smiles and reveals his true self. Krishnaji replies that both Arjuna and Krishnaji have had many births in the past. But the difference between humans and him is that we forget our past lives and he doesn't. Humans have such a strong tendency to identify with our body that we actually forget the lapse of time. For example, we may even forget where we left our keys in the morning. So our mind is moving at a much faster pace than actual time is. And that is the difference. Krishnaji is not restricted by these limitations. He reveals himself as the ultimate God. And he says that through his power called the Maya, he can control the whole universe or what we call Prakriti, the nature. And this harmony can be seen throughout the universe, all the planets, the moon, the earth, and how we relate to each other. Such a beautiful concept. Krishnaji says, whenever there's a decay in dharma or harmony and a rise in adharma or unrighteousness, I shall manifest to bring back harmony. This happens at every crisis, time and time again. And I do this for the protection of good people, destruction of evil people, and the establishment of dharma. Krishnaji says that we have to detach ourselves and become karmayogis. for which there are three stages. The first one is Shravana, which is hearing the scriptures, Manana, which is contemplating, and Nididhyasana, which is actually the understanding of the scriptures. This is called Jnana Tapas, or the austerity of knowledge. We then become devoted to Ishvara, or the supreme power. It is here that Krishna ji says that he is the supreme power. But us humans, we need an object to channel our concentration. And for this, he created deities or gods. A very fundamental point. Deities were created to channel our concentrations upon. Krishna ji mentions here that he created four classes of people so that we could perform our duties or swadharma effectively. And they were divided according to three gunas, and they are sattva, which is knowledge and peace, rajas, which is activity or agitation, tamas, which is lethargy or in need of motivation. So we have to perform a self-analysis to see how these gunas are behaving within us and what proportion we have of each of them. All of us fall into one of these four classes. A Brahmana who is predisposed to gaining knowledge, faith, sharing knowledge will usually have a prominence of sattva. A kshatriya who demonstrates courage, likes to organize and protect people, face challenges, take risks, and they will have a prominence of sattva and rajas. A vaishya who likes to be creative and produce something will have a prominence of rajas and tamas. And a shudra who likes to execute tasks but requires direction and motivation will have a prominence of tamas. There's a very incorrect notion that varna or classes are determined at birth. The Bhagavad Gita gives a very scientific manner in which we can select our career according to our own abilities, our own swadharma. We all live on this earth together and we each play a part. And this gives us a way of actually giving the best of us according to our own abilities. Krishna ji told Arjuna that the ancient rishis knew the meaning of I, meaning the eternal essence within. They didn't have to retire to a forest to find that out. They carried out their duties and became karmayogis. And this is the teaching that we have to get this self-realization through performance of action and not have to renounce anything in life. Krishna ji then goes on to describe the nature of the man with this knowledge. The Lord defines a wise man who sees actionlessness in all his body activities. This is called inaction. An example would be a hard-working man who does tough tasks all day without getting tired, as opposed to a lazy man. Next, he describes action inaction. This is a man with ego. He takes self-credit for everything without recognizing the eternal essence or the nature or what we call prakriti around us. And the person who gives up the sense of doership is now ready to become a karmayogi. The Lord says that if we treat all our actions of work as though we're performing a yajna, then all our goals will be met and we will begin to experience this eternal essence within us. Krishna ji says you have to detach yourselves and burn all your desires in this fire of knowledge. An example is of a bitter medicine, which our intellect knows will cure us, but our sense of taste and smell actually hate it. So the Lord tells us to use our own intellect to guide us through our swadharma and stop labeling anything as good or bad. So it's this distinction that really affects our mind. We have to treat everything the same. Therefore, we should remain alert all the time and keep reinstating our intellect over our senses. Now, another example is, say if you started a project, you started off well, you had all the plans laid down, but then you become distracted and the plan flops. So this is where the senses took over your intellect. An example we can put in our daily lives every day. As we grow up, we are conditioned by this world to think that the happiness is outside us, and we're constantly running after better jobs, cars, careers, houses, which don't actually eventually give us any happiness. But if we followed our duties or swadharma diligently, that wealth would have followed anyway. By constantly seeking happiness from external objects, we become slavishly dependent, And that makes us so restless. And then that's when we realize that everything is very, very temporary. We're always running, and never achieving the target that we set ourselves for. Krishna ji says that if we apply this yashna spirit in our daily lives, we will get internal happiness. As humans, we perform selfish actions as a result of an unhealthy relationship with the world. Each selfish action generates a negative reaction from the world, which accumulates as karma. The way out of this predicament is the correct knowledge. This is a healthy relationship with everyone around us when all traces of selfishness have gone. And this is done with the spirit of yashna. The human mind is always racing about thoughts and anxieties of the future. Lord Krishna gives us many ways of gaining this self-realization depending on the maturity of the person. Firstly, the worship of the deities. Most humans find it difficult to comprehend a formless Brahman. Therefore, deities were created through which puja could be done to connect with the god. Secondly, meditation. Some people prefer to realize the formless Brahman through contemplation. Thirdly, yajna, which is sacrificial fire ritual. Symbolically, self-control is like the fire to which the senses are offered. We use discretion over what we see, eat, or hear. This withdrawal of energy from the senses is called pratyahara. Fourthly, sacrifice. Advanced yogis sacrifice the notion that they live in a world of objects. They imagine the whole universe as a configuration of three cosmic energies, and that they form only a very small fraction of that energy. Fifthly, pranas. Even more advanced yogis can restrain the life forces of pranas within their body and attain stillness. He then withdraws attention from all the senses and redirects this energy towards the concentration, or what we call dhyana, in the eternal essence called samadhi. Lord Krishna gives us four types of yajnas. The first one is charity. By giving time or wealth, this should be done selflessly without a view for publicity. Number two, austerity or tapas. This is a selfless seva, service to the world. Thirdly, spiritual practice or bhakti yoga. Fourthly, study of the scriptures. Daily readings of any spiritual books, for example, the Ramayana or the Gita. Number five, pranayama. Mindful inhaling and exhaling quietens the mind. Number six, fasting. Restricting food intake and offering the first morsel to the deity. By controlling food intake, we can control our mind. It's almost as we are offering this sense of taste to God when we are fasting. Krishna ji urges us to implement at least one of these yajnas on our daily basis. Through this, we'll get internal happiness called amrita, which has the power to negate all our sorrows. One might ask, how will this yajna, which is a finite action, give this infinite happiness? And Krishna ji says that this is a first step towards self-realization. And the realization will happen when we know it's not I doing anything, but we are part of Prakriti, we are part of this nature, and we all have to play our part in it. Shri Krishna ji says we should begin by approaching a teacher who has two qualities. The first one is he should have realized the eternal essence himself. And secondly, he knows the technique of communicating this knowledge. And we ourselves should have this thirst for knowledge and be willing to learn with absolute humility and dedication. Krishna ji gives a very beautiful analogy. He says we can cross the river of all our sins with this boat of knowledge, meaning that the knowledge has the power to destroy all our sins. The teacher no doubt will guide us in the right direction, but it's our own effort, our focus, motivation, dedication will actually help us to get that knowledge. The true knowledge will come from within us, and it'll only come when we are ready. Shri Krishna ji points out that in addition to focus and sense control, we need faith. Faith in scriptures, teacher, ourselves, truth of the eternal essence, and be convinced there's something beyond the material world. Above all, we need restraint and control over our senses. If sense restraint is absent, our mind will wander from the spiritual path to a materialistic world. And it's this knowledge of self-realization that we have to get rid of our ego and this noise that's going on in our head, which will give us eternal peace. And ultimately, that is our goal. Actions continue to happen. But the one who has got the knowledge of self-realization, that I is not what's doing the whole actions, and has dispelled all the doubts in his head, is called an Atmavant. When we're operating at the level of a karmayogi, we express all our desires through performing actions, but we dedicate the results to Ishvara or the higher deity. So this is the concluding chapter 4. This is where Krishna ji is telling Arjuna to cast away all doubts and go back to fighting, go back to the war, go back to action. And the same goes to us. We have to put these teachings in practice and go and act in this world. Well, I hope you enjoy listening to that little bit of Bhagavad Gita. I'll be bringing chapter 5 next. But meanwhile, please do subscribe to my YouTube channel, Simple Hinduism. This is Shashi Gosain, Simple Hinduism. Thank you.